Like, I'm Chad, he's Marcus. We're gonna get off into this. Marcus, we're gonna start with number 10. Which TNA wrestler, or I guess we could say personality, do you think is never coming back to the company ever, ever, ever again?
Oh, yeah, dig it.
Not the legend, the guy that tried to step in the shadow. I'm talking about a TNA alumni. Former Black Machismo, now known worldwide, specifically in Ring of Honor, is one Jay Lethal.
It's a thing for this young man. Why do you think he's never coming back? I think that's the big point.
Yeah, one, I think, I mean, obviously, he had a unique run in TNA. I think he got far more out of that Black Machismo gimmick than a lot of people expected, maybe even more so than he expected. And then in trying to step out of that, didn't necessarily, I don't think he ever reached the bar he was trying to get to. So between that and I just think he would primarily like to keep the position he has now, which is kind of one of those head pieces in the company as opposed to just an added piece.
Mm-hmm.
And Ring of Honor, regardless of what may or may not be going on controversy-wise, that's probably it. I mean, essentially, he's made his name as a marquee guy in Ring of Honor, so to kind of deviate from that, I guess, in any form, maybe stepping down.
You're not wrong. For my next one, there's a theme, at least for these first two picks. My first pick, number 9, is going to go to New Jack.
Oh, wonder why.
New Jack is a man with issues. He's a little precocious, rambunctious. He marches to the beat of his own drum.
Like he's crazy, nut bad.
Yeah. Crazy nut bag, yeah, 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 yeah. You're not wrong. They brought him back in 2010, and here's the thing: he actually was in the company for about a year and a half or so between about 2003 and 2004, and he tagged up with Shark Boy, and his most famous segment involved him and Shark Boy in a kiddie pool while Shark Boy wore those old Hulk, Incredible Hulk punching gloves that were popular for a little while.
Oh yeah, yeah.
They just hung out doing that shit, and I'm just like, okay. I guess that's a thing you can do. But yeah, I don't see him ever coming back, mostly because with the new environment that wrestling is trying to get into, I just don't see there being much of a... It's too complicated, I think, for him to come back in today's environment. Maybe unfortunately, maybe fortunately. I don't know how people view him. I know I'm just not a fan of the guy. He's never really been that talented. Number 8.
Yeah, number 8 for me. Like Chad said, there's a thing.
There's a goddamn
thing. With these very few picks. That doesn't make it any less real for me. Got to go with, like you said, the first Black NWA champion. And one Ron Killings, also known as R-Truth. K-Quick. For those real throwbackers out there. But yeah, Ron Killings, man. I mean, again, another guy who had a very unique run in TNA. And also we know he's elsewhere now, but the man has proven he really is a 5-2 player in the business, not just in a specific company. But he's that guy there, even amidst all the crap that happens. He's the guy that's going to lead that company when he wants to.
Mm-hmm.
It feels like, and not the other way around, because it's just like, if you don't get him character-wise, then you probably love him as a human, which I'm pretty sure you'd be perplexed to find anybody in that company, whether they are a douche or otherwise, to have a bad word to say about him. So I just feel like, you know, now, again, like I said, I feel like he's a lifer for that company. I'm not saying that he couldn't, but at this point, Yeah, he's just, I mean, he kind of is what he's going to be. But that being said, just all the stuff that he did in TNA is still some classic stuff.
He's one of the good ones, Marcus. And I wish he would come back, because he's truly one of those kinds of talents. For me, my next pick is going to be El Señor Hogan of the Hulk variety. I don't, like, even if he's like, all right, brother, I want to come back. I'm just hoping Don Callis and Scott D'Amore go, pass. We're in negotiations with Randy Savage's ghost. We don't think you guys would get along. Like, just come up with any excuse possible. Because let's be honest. TNA between 2004 to 2009 was on an upward trajectory. They were getting their highest ratings, their best house shows. They had a mobile game. They had a console game. They had a mobile text service. They had, like, umpteen trading cards and chips. They had chips, Marcus. Physical bag of chips.
Actually, live crowds. Still had Don West, which is a bonus for anyone.
Right? Donnie West selling them bags. I bought a bunch of those bags. I still use those bags. The brown bags, they're actually more like an off-white, but all right, fair enough. So, yeah, Hogan coming into TNA was an absolute travesty. It wrecked so much shit. And thankfully, we don't have to worry about that man ever coming back ever again.
Yeah, and if anybody's interested, go back in our archives. I think we did a specific Hogan episode where we kind of just broke down like his just whole mentality during that time. Like it was a vanity project. He used the company for a vanity project to get back to whatever standard he thought that character should still be at. Mm-hmm. And also, obviously, money, because, you know, just the stuff going through at the time. But yeah, that's basically what it was. So he's going to come up again, but it's not because of something he wanted to do. It's just because it was, you know, what was happening at the time. Obviously, we didn't know things were going to go off several cliffs after, but you know.
One could say all the cliffs.
All the cliffs.
All the cliffs. All right, Marcus, your next one up.
Yeah, this next one up for me, it's another big name, and it sucks because of just their DNAs in the brand itself. But I'm going with the King of the Mountain himself, Jeff Jarrett. Obviously, we know the man started the company. He's very much his lifeblood in it. Also, a main player, both, you know, in front of and behind the camera in a lot of ways. And then, you know, that slowly, you know, both in front of and behind the camera just kind of deteriorated over the years, whether it was from faulty business dealings or very personal issues that, you know, came up with in terms of work business relationships intertwining, possibly sinking your entire ship. That, and then the fact that he went and started another company, wasn't necessarily getting the traction for that he needed. Tried to come back to his old company and basically merge, aka take it over. They used that as a foundation for his new company, and then that not going through. Ultimately, that company then folding and him going to WWE. Yeah, you know, I just think he's real settled where he is right now, and he probably doesn't want to be in any association with TNA or Impact in any way. You know, it's just kind of a chapter that he's closed, I guess, understandably in a way, but it kind of sucks because he very much is rooted in the DNA of that company.
Yeah, I want to say that I'd like to see him come back, but honest to goodness, Marcus, this man has burned more bridges than the retreating Confederacy back in the day, because they were always running like the yellow dogs they were. He is someone I will always appreciate and always love. But he proved that as a leader, he could make poor judgment decisions. And that was on two different occasions as the head of the company. So, no thank you. My next one up is actually the head of his own company. And he's done more than enough things to make me no longer be a fan of his, and that's Cody Rhodes. People forget Cody was in TNA for a while. Like 3 weeks, but still. It counts. He had like a 4-month run from like, what was it? October of 2016 or yeah, to March of 2017. And it wasn't very impressive. He won the Global Force Next Gen title. What a terrible name. And it was spelled N-E-X-G-E-N with like a little star in between. That was bad. He feuded with Moose and Michael Bennett, and that was really it. But since he's taken over the head of AEW, or one of the heads of AEW, he's really just been problematic as a boss. He turns a blind eye to talent accusations, which fucking fires me up something fierce. He's constantly kind of making his issues with WWE the forefront of all of his storylines. That stupid neck tattoo. And goddamn, he loves all of the worst shit in spite of everything. Like, his favorite Star Wars movie is The Last Jedi. Like, that tells you who he is. He's the guy who wants people to be angry at him. Well, congrats, Cody. You gone and done it. Marcus, next one up. Oh, also, he's not coming back because why the fuck would he? He's getting paid a lot of money to sit on his ass and do nothing, so.
Yeah, and do Hot Ones commercials or Hot Ones segments in the middle of a show. But I digress. For me, my next up... it's going to be the phenomenal one, AJ Styles. This one stings. Only because, again, like Jared, somebody that's so synonymous with that brand, I mean, he is one of the reasons why I think a lot of people, not just me, gravitated towards the product in those early 2000s. And it felt like he definitely was the guy, even though, and I guess that's the overall narrative when it comes to Styles, unfortunately, in the company that should have had him as the guy. Mm-hmm. He was the guy that never was the guy. It's unfortunate how people, you know, how the ball got fumbled or whatnot. That, you know, because he would have stayed, but, you know, they didn't necessarily come to, I guess, a proper financial agreement. And he went on and he thrived. Probably more than he ever imagined, you know, from the Indies to, you know, New Japan. And then also we've seen the success from there. So. He literally has no reason to come back at this point. I imagine he's a maid, living good somewhere in a gated community. in a gated community. And, you know, I'm pretty sure he feels like, you know, he got his proper treatment both financially and character-wise positioned in a big way in WWE. And I can't, you know. And to me, I think his New Japan run is peak. But again, it is New Japan. But still, he literally probably has no reason to come back. And that sucks. But, you know, it kind of is what it is. He was kind of one of those last Mohicans for me that kind of let me know, like, once guys like him, I mean, obviously Jared jumped ship him, and then guys like JB, yeah, this probably is never going to be, you know, the same again. But, you know, that's kind of how it goes.
They took away our fun, Marcus.
Yes, they did.
Took away our fun. So, my next pick is going to be a current NXT talent. And this is more or less not so much on him not wanting to come back to the company, but on my belief that Impact would never do business with him again, and that's Killer Cross, Karrion Cross, whatever the fuck their dumbass name is calling it. I will say this. You brought up Jeff Jarrett's little failed adventure way back in the day. 2014, 2015. One of the big names that he scouted was, in fact, Killer Cross. Jeff Jarrett got that good eye for talent. But Cross is a bit of a D-bag, a bit of a diva, and has routinely been kind of perceived as hard to work with. I hope that's not truly the case, but that's how I've been hearing it. And I think it's only a matter of time before he runs afoul in NXT. And let's be honest, it's not exactly like NXT has always had the easiest talents come in and do work with them. So I am very interested to see how that goes.
They kind of, I mean, they ran off Deonna Purrazzo. I mean, she's one of the few people in the business that says screw NXT, not WWE. I think she said that during the interview. I was like, that is very interesting because usually it's the other way around. But that kind of lets you know, like, just certain things of how things go on in all facets of that company. So
kind of makes you wonder why. Kind of makes you wonder why. Marcus, last one up for you. What you got for me?
Last one up for you, and this is a shout out to Chad because this is his main man. I'm going with the Stinger. Sting. I mean, what, he was with the company, what, from 2004 to what?
Well, he popped up in 03 and 04 for kind of like two shows each year. He came back full time in 2006, and he was there until 2014, so about 8 years.
Yeah.
9 years.
Absolute. Yeah, absolute legend, not debatable. I mean, you name it in the company, he did it. Still one of the highlights of his time there is Joker Sting for me.
That's actually the picture I used.
Nice. And yeah, it's just, aside from him, unfortunately, being done pretty much in ring-wise, thanks, Nazi Fire. But,
did someone say my name?
Is that you or your newborn? Doesn't matter.
Yeah. On my shoulder.
Hold on, wait a minute. I have to send somebody else's girl a pick. No, but, Sting, man. It's, you did about all you could do. You know, he kind of reminds me a lot of ways in LAX, and that, you know, it's not, you know, the man gave everything for the company. Probably a lot of times where it was, you know, put probably beneath him in certain situations in terms of stuff that he was involved with. Specifically, like that whole thing with Jeff, that was an embarrassment, you know. And obviously, you know, we saw the journey from there, but, you know, Sting was definitely that guy, man. Like you said, you've always praised him, and rightfully so. He was with that company through so many periods where he really could have just threw his hands up, left, and he didn't do it. And I do think, you know, one thing I can say, I do think that schedule and the way that they did things allowed for guys like Sting and the Hardys and Angle really to prolong what, specifically those three guys, their life.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff and Kurt, but, you know, Sting shouldn't have been, you know, had a no really rigorous schedule, even with him being as great as he was at his age. So, yeah, you know, I don't think Sting, and in some way he's watching that. I just feel like he has, like, that Last Ride documentary on repeat every day.
I can see it.
Just waiting for him to say one thing that'll make him believe that he wants that match that he, you know, that, like, our Boneyard match could have been better. Like, I see that going off in his head. So, unfortunately, we won't be seeing no more of the Stinger, but his bat is definitely hanging up in the Impact rafters.
I hope you're wrong about this. I don't necessarily need to see him back as a competitor, but as far as, like, an on-screen presence, I think he would still be money. He is 61, though, so I have to wonder how much he actually wants to travel. Because I do hear that old men don't like to move around too much. Just saying. But if he wants to go full Terry Funk and wrestle till he's 80, I'm fine with that too. I have no issues. Except for the last one. The last one for me, the last one for this topic, is going to be Old Man Flair. The Wooster. I got nothing else. He'll never come back. Like, even Hogan lasted longer than Flair. Flair literally got fired from the company because he could not be trusted to do his job. I don't think D'Amore would ever want to bring him back. And truthfully, them dentures he's got ain't working because he's always, either he's perpetually drunk or his teeth are coming up, because whenever he's on screen, he sounds like this. And I'm just like, Flair never used to sound like he was perpetually drunk. Flair's gotten to a point where in the ring, out of the ring, doesn't matter where, he's lost his TV aura, I say. He is 71, so I do wonder why he's, one, being paraded out all the time, and two, why anyone still wants to see him. Like, it's one thing, like, to hear, like, an interview with him or to, like, do, like, a signing with him or what have you, or, like, a, you know, a Q&A. But to see him involved in actual angles still, like, why?
Yeah, it's weird. I think that's what kind of where him and Hogan have a lot in common. I don't know if he can ever really be content not being Ric Flair. Like, there's a, like I said, like, it's all those years where it felt like he almost, like, passed on every year. Like, he was getting admitted to the hospital, stuff was happening, you didn't know, it was shaky. And obviously with his history, you imagine things come to roost eventually, but he's evaded the Grim Reaper a amount of times, and it's like, you think somebody like him would want to sit down, but he's traveling a lot, you know, doing, specifically being on TV and in that company during this whole pandemic thing. We've never seen him in a mask. So it's, I don't know, man. I just think, again, like, you know, Terry Bollea's obsession with Hulk Hogan, I feel like, you know, what is it, Reed Flair's obsession with Ric Flair. So,
well, Reed's his son. Ric Flair's real name is actually, I think, Rick.
No.
But it's spelled F-L-E-I-H-R.
Yeah, Flair. Yeah, something
Flair.
Like that.
Flair.
Yeah, so.
Richard Morgan Flair. What are you, Canadian, Rick?
And I mean, who knows? I mean, you may think, you know, you only don't got that many years left, so you want to be around to see. Even if he's not openly in an angle working with Charlotte, he wants to be close to, you know, see her do a thing, which, you know, I get. But, you know, man, you're risking a lot specifically right now when, you know, if you get COVID, man, it's you know, going to be the Ben one.
Yeah. Don't want to go there. So, with that being said, that's our list for Monday night. This is recorded, obviously. Go to realnerdcorp.com, RealNerdCorp.com, Twitter, NERDCORP, Instagram, RealNerdCorp. We're on iTunes, Spotify, and Podbean. Links will be on the website or underneath the YouTube channel video thingy. It's in there in the description down below. Like, subscribe, comment, I don't care, do whatever you want. Marcus Green can be found on Twitter at ParadoxKid, ParadoxKid.
That is me.
And if you want to hear him gasp, stutter, and try to make sense of New Japan's booking, you can do so over on Twitter at TruePennyShow, the TruePennyShow, at TruePennyShow on Twitter, TruePennyShow. And you can find me on Twitter at Chad Nerdcorp, ChadNerdCorp, and on Instagram at Chad's Photo Hut. Marcus, any final thoughts?
Nope, that's all.
And we'll see you guys on Wednesday for our top 10 TNA Impact debuts. 2509. That's where we're cutting it. That's where we're